Welcome to part two of the interview with Meena Dimian.
That's right.
We're here, episode 10 of the Funny Indian Show, the tangent show being the sort of the, I don't know, the byline, the tagline. I don't know what we want to call that.
You could go slogan.
Like a slogan.
We're bold enough to say slogan.
A slogan, motto, you know, yeah. Credo, if you happen to have a credo. A penny saved is a penny earned. Chevy Chase, best movie of all time,
Whatever.
Vacation, my favorite. We've been going through a number of the questions, and in our second half we'll go through some more, but, you know, I always find that the best conversations are the ones where we just, that's why it's called the tangent show. It's a tangent. I mean, like,
right.
we go on all these things, and we don't need to necessarily get through all the questions.
I think it's important.
That's not what it is. I think
it's important for people to be heard, sure.
I think it's important for people to be heard. We're hosts. We believe that. I do want to do a scene from our this is funny that it's our favorite scene.
From
I'm putting you on the spot because we didn't talk about this.
When we, I'm going to preface this.
Please do.
When we first met through our mutual friend.
Absolutely.
We really didn't, you know, it was probably awkward and we didn't have much to talk about. We were probably drinking or something.
Sure. And our mutual friend's Monrock, right?
Right.
Because she's been on the show. She did episode
comedian
3.
Comedian and actress, brilliant.
Absolutely. M-O-N-R-O-K.
Stunningly beautiful and brilliant actress.
Absolutely.
And great stand-up, of course.
Yeah.
We clung to Seinfeld, which
yeah.
is really what has become, like, our pop culture's encyclopedia.
Yeah, absolutely.
Yeah, that's how people relate to each other. I was in a village in the Middle East.
Yeah.
And I had nothing to talk to this guy, and he said, "Do you like George Costanza?"
Amazing.
That's what he said.
Amazing.
That's the kind of impact that Larry David and Jerry have had on
even the Middle Eastern
world.
Yeah,
all over. It's
yeah.
a global thing. Yeah, so anyway, we've talked about how much we love this scene, which is from, I believe, season 2, and it's this scene with, or season 3, maybe. This
maybe
season,
it is, yeah. Or maybe it's, yeah, it's one of those seasons.
Elaine's psychologist boyfriend.
Psychiatrist, yeah. May I offer you something to drink?
Do you want me? I want me to be the psychologist.
You want to be the psychologist?
I'll
do the
guy.
You do the psychologist. I may have blown the first line.
You do a better Cosmo.
I do a better Cosmo.
Yeah.
Okay, absolutely.
So, may I offer you something to drink?
Oh, okay, sure. I'll take a, do you have a decaf cappuccino?
I'm sorry, I don't think that we have that.
That's a little strange.
Why does that surprise you?
It's a very popular drink.
This is an office.
That's true.
Yeah.
I don't know why that's my favorite. I can't believe it's your favorite scene. It's the best scene.
It's stunning.
It's
musical.
It's just so funny. Just the awkwardness of it, and it's just it's amazing. I'm glad we're.
It's really
on the
just
same page.
Michael Richards' delivery is.
He's spot on.
Yeah, spot on. Really.
Let me ask you this.
Yeah.
We're talking about
sure.
psychiatrists, psychology, whatever. We're going to try to segue. You know, I bought a segue, but I haven't found a place to drop it into the conversation.
Here we go.
You know, this guy.
Here we go.
This guy. Let me ask you. What is the least attractive quality a person can have?
Arrogance.
Okay. I hear that a lot on the show.
It's gotta be arrogance.
Yeah.
No, nobody likes somebody who thinks they know what they're doing.
Yeah.
That's
yeah.
the least sexy quality that
sure.
somebody might have. You know, we see that predominantly in, like, things like, you know, media and the news and politics. And people that really have the answers usually aren't saying much. That's really what
yeah.
I go for.
Yeah.
The people that are really thinking are the ones writing books, not the ones making TV appearances.
Interesting.
So
are there people who do both?
That's fine.
And Salman Rushdie.
Sure, of course. I mean, Salman Rushdie's got a lot to say, and he's a brilliant thinker mm-hmm. and writer and, you know, mm-hmm. man. But also a great cameo in Bridget Jones, Salman, if you're listening.
My brother actually has met him a number of times.
Rakesh.
Yeah, Rakesh Shetty
yes.
is an author.
Who,
Rakesh,
by the way, yeah. is also brilliant.
Brilliant and very show business himself.
Oh, I mean, the king of show business.
He's the epitome.
He does it all.
He does it all. He's met Salman a few times.
Yeah.
I mean, fellow authors. Well, what
sure.
does Costanza say to the president of NBC? Colleagues, if I may.
Colleagues. Working together.
Yeah, absolutely.
I think arrogance is really, it's really a pitfall. It's mm-hmm. the pitfall of humanity. The idea
pride,
that,
yeah.
that we have the answers.
Yeah.
You know, I think the most healthy minds in the world are the ones that always have a question.
Mm-hmm.
I find that.
A wise man always doubts. Only a fool is certain.
That's right.
And I'm sure about that.
And hey, of course.
Yeah.
Yeah.
This guy.
Yeah.
Yeah.
All right.
Super joke book, everybody.
Oh, my God.
Read that in third grade.
It's a good thing you brought the book.
Brought the book. I wrote the book, I think. I wrote this stuff. Why can't I remember it? Winnebago Man.
That's another thing that we did together. We went to the Tonight Show.
Went to Jay Leno's show.
We saw Winnebago Man's first TV appearance. It was fantastic.
It was his first conscious.
Exactly.
TV appearance. You sort of started to segue a little bit into this. All these questions are open-ended, but this one is particularly wide open. Who has it figured out?
Oh, who has it figured out?
Mm-hmm.
Ha. You mean historically? Or as a people?
Interpret any way you'd like.
Well, you know, I've read some books by some people that I think have the right idea.
Read all the major texts, right?
No. Oh, you mean
the Quran,
religious
the
texts.
Gita,
yes, I studied Islam
and
I studied Hinduism and Taoism and Taoism.
Yeah.
And the various religions in college. I grew up Christian, of course. That's what happens.
Yeah.
Because it's easy. I like Santa Claus.
Indeed.
I think really the people that haven't figured out are the ones that are quiet and looking for the answers again, I would say. But the religions are fine. I'm not really a believer in any specific religion. I take religion for what it is, really. It's just a man-made idea.
Uh-huh.
And that doesn't make it wrong or right. Uh-huh. But it's to say that any specific religion is the one and final law is the epitome of ignorance.
Yeah.
You know, because, you know, the three religions that we have now are just, you know, they're just current. We've had 20 other religions before it that have come and gone with the wind, just like these will. But the people really that have a figure.
Now you sound like John Lennon.
It'll
vanish and shrink.
Sure.
You know, right now we're bigger than that. We're bigger than Jesus.
Exactly.
Yeah.
I mean, the people that have figured out are, you know, the thinkers. The people that have stepped back and kind of dropped their egos and, you know, like I've mentioned in the past, Alan Watts, by the way, you guys can Google, YouTube him.
Tell me about Alan Watts.
Alan Watts was a British philosopher in the 20th century. Mm-hmm. He was born in the 40s or 50s, I believe.
Okay.
I'm sorry. He passed in the 70s or 80s.
Okay.
So I guess he was born in the 30s or 40s. And he studied in London at Oxford and then moved to San Francisco in his later years to teach and to write. And he was just a magnificent thinker. And, this guy was a Presbyterian priest. He was a Hindu scholar. He was a Taoist. He studied all the Eastern religions and the Western religions. He was a really learned man. And he was the author of a miniseries in the 70s, which is available on YouTube for free.
Really?
And the series, it's in three parts. It's called A Conversation with Myself.
Okay.
Magnificent piece. Everybody should listen to it if you want to open your heart and mind and learn something a little bigger than things written in books. Old books.
Yeah.
So, really, that's what he's a real, you know, he's a real great thinker. And, you know, I guess he had to figure it out. He probably did.
No, I've got two major follow-ups from this. And the Zeitgeist.
Zeitgeistmovie.com.
I gotta really check that out.
Please do.
When Hollywood makes a movie about your life, who's gonna play you?
Oh, a very unfortunate individual. When Hollywood makes a movie about your life, who's going to play it? I hope it's somebody that's having a good time. That's somebody that can deliver having a good time.
That's you.
That's my motto in life.
Yeah.
Have a good time.
Have a good time all of the time.
That's right.
Spinal Tap.
That's right.
So, yeah, it's like I have a motto in life, it's have a good time all of the time.
That's right.
And I love the... not that the movie has much of a plot, but I love at the ending where he's just like, do you feel like you could have been, when Rob Reiner is interviewing a guy, do you feel like you could have been happy with some other...
Looks like Frank Coppola.
Do you feel like you could have been happy doing another profession? I thought it could be like a haberdasher or something like that. Maybe it seems like help you, what size are you? You know, what kind of, you know, come in and you think you could be happy?
You think you could be happy doing that?
I don't know, what are the hours? That's the last last line of the movie. It's so fantastic. It's so great.
Well, all those guys, by the way. God. Those guys, you know what? I'll tell you. I will say this about, you know, guests and all those geniuses.
Yeah.
Those guys have comedy figured out.
They have comedy figured out.
They really do.
I would agree
along with Ricky Gervais and all the modern geniuses. Really, those are the guys that really, really have a sense of what it takes to be funny.
Gervais said in, I think it's in BigThink.com, he said this video player,
which
whatever.
Is amazing.
Which is amazing.
Free.
We're watching some of those. And free.
And free.
Check those out too, free.
Yeah.
And he was, he talked about comedy and the direction of it. They asked him about the future of comedy. He ended up talking a lot about the past. But he said he believes that comedy has never been improved upon past Laurel and Hardy.
That's right.
So Laurel and Hardy, everything is derivative from that.
Recently, I did an interview for Time Out magazine, and I said that they were talking about all the great comics that have inspired me and that are currently inspiring me. Mm-hmm. You know, Louis C.K., Bill Burr, Joe DeRosa, all these guys.
Yeah.
Jake Johansson, obviously. The people that have inspired me, these comics aren't necessarily just saying something.
Right.
They're saying something that's been said before,
right.
But they're really saying it their own way.
Yeah.
And most things, really, in comedy have been said before.
Almost everything, everywhere has been said before.
You and I are mutual fans of Dane Cook.
Absolutely.
We both like Dane Cook.
Yeah.
Even though the comedy world came down very hard on Dane Cook.
I hate him, but I love him.
After they built him up, Show Business 101.
Absolutely.
That's what we do.
And then we'll build him back up.
And we'll build him back up.
Pull him down, we'll put him back up. Absolutely.
So, you know, Dane is a good example of somebody who says it his own way. And people came out and they said, oh, well, he steals from so-and-so and he rips people. Everybody steals. Everybody does. I do. Not in the sense of we watch Richard Pryor and then we do a Richard Pryor joke.
Right, right, right.
But everybody does the same concept.
What does it say? Good artists borrow and great artists steal.
That's exactly right.
Yeah.
And that's Woody Allen, right? I believe that said that.
I forget who said that.
I think so, but Woody Allen's another one. Yeah. And he admits it likewise, that really the greatest, you know, the people that achieve the greatness are the ones that get inspired by an idea and then deliver it differently.
Yeah.
And that's, you know, that is exactly what Ricky was talking about. Ricky Gervais was talking about.
First-name basis.
Right, exactly. First-name basis. I rejected my invite to the Emmys.
Yeah. His speech there was brilliant, too, of course.
Fantastic.
You know.
Absolutely fantastic. Talk about stealing the show in 2.5 minutes.
Yeah, that's him.
Fantastic.
That's what he can do. He's amazing in that regard. That's awesome. I was going to say something else about that. You said Woody Allen stealing things. Okay, I don't remember what it was now. We'll get there. It'll come back around, I'm sure.
Yeah.
Do you use your college degree? What was your college degree in?
I studied philosophy.
Okay.
At Rutgers
Religion.
University.
Okay, Rutgers. Yeah.
Yeah, and
I've done Rutgers 3 times.
That's right.
Yeah,
exactly.
I have.
We've both actually probably done the same room.
Bush campus, I'm sure. Is that
Bush
what
campus?
It was?
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah. College Ave. I actually went to Newark. Which is where the philosophy program
which is
very strong.
About the scariest city I've ever
that's
been.
That's true. Well, I was only shot twice. I was lucky.
you've got a few to become 50 Cent.
I will say that, just to be frank, when I was studying in college, I hated it.
You hated Rutgers?
I hated philosophy.
Really?
I hate the modern education system. I don't think it's the proper way to learn. I don't think the proper way to learn is for 30 people to sit in a room and face a wall. I don't think that's how it goes.
Even though we're stand-ups, and that's really
exactly what we do.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
I think it's a good platform for a performer.
Okay.
But not so much for an educator. I think educators are the ones that that can deliver parallels. You
okay.
know, parallels in nature and humanity and so on and so
okay.
forth. And really, that's what college was lacking. But, that being said,
sure.
I learned amazing things that I carried with me in my later 20s. And that I was able to relate to, you know, in my independent studying,
right.
you know.
Talk a little bit more about the education system, because I took a class called Sociology of Education.
Of course.
In college, of course.
Sure.
And my mom taught elementary school for 36 years.
That's right. I did not know that your mom
taught,
was an educator.
For, for a long time, and now she teaches Hindi at Miami University in Oxford, Ohio.
Wow, okay.
And she's taught it for a couple of years, and it's been very interesting for her to go. She always wanted to teach on a college campus. I think everyone in our family is drawn to college. I love college campuses.
Me too.
I just think that they are great for young girls. And so I like, I would go high school, but you just, that kind of thing is not accepted.
We're on the radio here, Rajiv.
We're on the
interweb.
We're on the worldwide interweb. Another guest reference right there,
right.
Fred Willard, I think it was. But no, I I love the energy.
Can I say one thing about Fred Willard? Because we both love Fred Willard so much. Yeah. I will give a one-liner joke by Fred Willard. It's not mine. This is Fred Willard's joke.
I wonder if it's going to be the same one I quoted earlier today. Let's find out. Okay. Let's find out.
Blind prostitutes.
That's it. I quoted it today.
You can
say it. Dude, you can finish it. Go for
Blind prostitutes. You got to hand it to him.
Phenomenal. It's in for your consideration.
That's right.
But he's there. He's like, you know, the thing about blind prostitutes, what they say, you really got to hand it to him. Like, he's laughing through
the whole thing. I think it's really his favorite joke, and it's a great joke.
Phenomenal joke. Rutgers philosophy education. Yeah.
Yeah.
My mom has taught blah blah blah, that good stuff. And I love college campus. I love the energy of them. I guess, what do you mean by the modern education system being flawed or broken or whatever? Because that's a topic that's near and dear to my heart. Because I have a philosophy on it too, but I want to hear yours.
Let me amend what I just said. It's not that the modern education system is wrong or improper. I just think that it's not universal, which is what we've come to learn. We've come to behave in that manner.
Okay.
Things are taught pretty much the same way throughout the world. It's a classroom. There's a finite amount of classes. There's a schedule. And there's expectations for you to achieve a certain mark in an exam at the end of the road. That's a fine way to learn. That's not the way everybody learns. Some people learn by writing. Some people learn by listening. Some people learn by seeing.
Mm-hmm.
Some people aren't done learning when the course is over.
Mm-hmm.
You know, like you can get your doctorate in metaphilosophy from Oxford, and you still have a hunger to learn.
Yeah.
But that's really as high as you can go in education, you know?
Right, everything
is very standardized.
Right.
And I think humanity is not standardized. We're ever evolving. People learn different ways. The species is changing. Why isn't our education system changing? And I think that, again, to go back and to just constantly hit this point home, obviously, which is what I guess my subconscious is trying to do, is that also is an opportunity that we now have through YouTube and the internet and so on, is that people... We don't go to get education anymore. Education comes to us.
Sure.
In tweets, in Facebook alerts, in, you know, YouTube, explosions.
Mm-hmm.
And that's really, you know, what's promising about the future. And I was a child of that generation. I was a child of the transitional generation of education.
Mm-hmm.
So what you were going to say?
Well, it's interesting. That's great perspective. Here's what I would ask you. How would you change it? What would be the thing you would do?
I would give people a chance to learn things at the foot of the thinkers they want to learn from.
Okay.
So if you admire an author, they should be able to teach. And not specifically in, like you said, in the confines of a campus or something. Mm-hmm. But there should be some kind of alternative, you know? And I think that's really now is when we have the opportunity for it. You actually have now, we have classes that you can take at Yale. Online, you can take them online, and there's no grades, there's no, it's not competitive, and I think that is the biggest flaw in the education system, is that it's become very competitive.
Oh, yeah,
you have to get high grades so that you can advance to a higher school, so that you can earn a large salary, and that you can finance a home, or whatever, and get all these...
It's essentially a game.
Yes, exactly. And that's, by the way, what... Alan Watts, he was the first person to call it a game.
He's not game theory, is he?
No.
Okay, he's not game theory.
He's not game theory, but he was the first person to come out and say that life is, you know, it's like a song. You know, it's music. You're supposed to dance and sing to it. It's not structured.
Yeah, it's very much a game in that Huston and I were talking last night about Michael Jordan.
Sure.
And Huston is a big basketball person. We're going to have him on the show eventually. I've told him he's my fail-safe, though, when I'm down to the wire and I need an interview, because he's my roommate, I can just hit him up.
A great comedian, also.
And a very, very good comedian. HustonMinhaj.com. Very funny guy.
Plug him.
Plug him. Plug everybody. But no, we plug our friends, and I think we're all talented. I think we were talking about Jordan, and we said something along the lines of... I don't think Jordan so much, he loved basketball, but I think he loved winning. And he found something he could just win at. He's like, I can win at basketball, and I'm going to do that.
His version of success.
His version of success. Mm-hmm. Whereas like Bobby Knight, who coached Indiana forever, he hated losing.
That's right.
He didn't even care about winning.
He just
hated losing.
It was unacceptable to him.
It was unacceptable to lose. Mm-hmm. And I'm like, man, you're signing up for a lifetime of
frustration.
Frustration. Because you're going to lose every now and then.
That's
you're not going to win at
natural.
all. You know, I mean, even Jordan didn't win every game. He didn't hit every shot.
Well, I mean, he was a chair thrower, Bobby Knight. I mean, you know, we've all seen his blooper reel.
Yeah,
I mean, you
know. And it's one for the ages,
but
one for the reels. But a legendary coach.
Of course.
And hell of a cook. That's from Christmas Vacation. You ever see her, the yak woman? She's got these two horns growing out of the side of her head. Ugly sin, but a sweet gal.
Let me note also that Christmas Vacation is another one.
Oh, phenomenal.
Of course. That's one of the classics, one of the few
third movies that's any good in a series. But I think that's the case. It's like, just like Michael Jordan loved winning, I feel like, I remember the valedictorian in our class, I asked him, he was not the smartest kid in our class, and very good friend of mine, and I asked him, I'm like, how do you get A's in classes? Like, you recognize that Chris and Danny are smarter than you.
You confronted him.
Oh, yeah, yeah. Okay. And because we were very good friends. We still are. And I was just like, and I was friends with Chris and Danny, too. I was like, Chris and Danny are smarter than you.
Brighter than you, yeah.
They're brighter than you. Like, how do you do it? How are you number one? I was like, you deserve it. You work hard. And he goes, and he just summed it up when he just goes, I just am good at getting A's.
Ah.
He didn't cheat. He didn't steal. He had none of that. He was very ethical.
But he knows how to beat the system.
He just knew how to get A's.
Yeah.
He goes, I can just get A's. I don't know how to explain it any better.
To me, those are the smartest people.
Yeah, they can just play the game.
They figured it out that it's all structured and there's a way to get through it without breaking your back.
It's true, and
I think that's, you know, that's also something for everybody to learn across the board. It's not about working hard, which is what we're doing right now in the world. It's about working smart.
Working smart.
Really.
They say that I learned that from Scrooge McDuck in one of the DuckTales.
That's where I get all my philosophical ideas.
You can't go wrong with Scrooge McDuck. Although I never understood the relationship between Scrooge McDuck and Ebenezer Scrooge. Whatever happened to Ebenezer Scrooge?
I don't know.
Scrooge McDuck.
He got screwed.
He got Scrooged. Like Bill Murray got screwed.
And how do you swim through those coins? I tried that. It hurts.
It is. It's not. Drake can do it.
Yeah.
Drake talks about swimming through money. Find him Nemo. That's it. I like to quote hip hop as often as I possibly can.
Yeah.
Because I'm so hood.
Ethnic.
So thugged out. Yeah. Ethnic. I'm very ethnic in that regard. What would it mean to? That's one of my other favorite questions. What would it mean to pull a U? Oh, man, that guy just pulled a Meena.
Pulled a Meena.
What would that be if you pulled a Meena?
Blow off your greatest fear in the midst of disaster.
Is that right?
I think so. I've been... The few things that I've been commended for in my life is trying to stay cool under lousy circumstances.
And you've succeeded at it.
I try, you know, not alone, you know, the good help of alcohol and marijuana.
And heroin.
Of course, and black tar.
Right.
But,
yam yam.
Yam yam, right. But I think, you know, I think it's an easier life to live like Jordan rather than Bobby Knight.
Yeah.
Where, you know, have a good time.
Yeah.
Have a good time with it. You know, you're going to lose every now and then. Mm-hmm. And I face that. You know, we all face it every day.
Mm-hmm.
You're not going to get every opportunity that you seek.
Especially in comedy and entertainment, you're going to get a few.
Kidding? If you get a few, you're lucky.
Yeah, absolutely.
You know?
Lightning has to strike multiple times.
That's right. Mm-hmm. And I was sitting next to, actually, this is kind of a weird show business story. I won't drop any names, but I will say I was on a flight from New York to LA recently.
Sure.
And I found myself sitting next to the president of one of the biggest talent agencies in the world.
Oh, great.
Randomly.
Uh-huh.
And, you know, I didn't notice. He was an older guy, a guy like in his 60s or 50s or 60s. And I kind of leaned over, as I usually do on long flights and when I get bored of the DirecTV and the Wi-Fi and all the technology that we have. But, you know, I get bored. And I like to talk to people.
Oh, right.
And I leaned over to him. I said, hey, if I buy you a drink, would you tell me a little bit about life? Would you give me some life advice?
Because you knew who he was.
No, I didn't at the time. He just was an older guy. And I liked, you know, because you never know what you can pick up on the road.
Yeah. And you were in first class?
I was bumped up to business accidentally.
Okay.
Totally accidentally.
Because first class advice is very different from coaching.
Oh, of course.
They say if you take financial advice from your neighbor, he's going to be your neighbor for a long time.
That's exactly right. Mm-hmm. And this guy was not my neighbor. This guy was a powerhouse. I mean, I looked him up afterwards.
Right, after
the flight. And I told him about what I've done and, you know, the things that I'm working on. And I told him about my goals. And I said, well, what do you think? You know, how lucky do I have to get to where I want to be?
Yeah.
And he's like, you know, buddy, I got to tell you, sounds like you've been pretty lucky so far. And and that's kind of a good wake-up call. And I think everybody needs to do that, especially in this silly little game that we play called show business.
Sure.
You have to really appreciate the little breaks that you do get. And, you know, I'm trying to have a good time. Again, I'm young, so it's easy for me to say that now. But you know, I've been lucky, and, you know.
Well, that segues, because we're almost out of time.
Okay.
That segues nicely into the last two questions I want to get into.
Great.
And we haven't covered them all, but we've covered a good number of them.
Great.
And I'd love to have you on in the future. I think we could chop it up.
We'll make some calls.
We'll make some calls. Well, my people call you. We'll do lunch. We'll do leftover pizza as I was eating it.
It would be earlier. My great pleasure.
It was like eating the apple when Costanza calls up the girl. I was like, exactly. A little too... Enough
of
the apple.
Cool.
Right?
Trying to stay cool.
Yeah, too casual. I want to write a joke, by the way, about how the United States, we're talking about politics and just war and everything, how we just don't care. Because we even call them casualties.
That's
we're
right.
We're even casual about that.
Oh, excellent. That's a great joke.
I think that's a fair...
Write that down.
I wonder if anyone's done that. I want to do that.
Patrice O'Neill has a great thing about America, how we don't care.
But he says the casualty.
No.
Okay.
That's yours.
But Patrice O'Neill is a genius.
Oh, I love him. He's fantastic.
Very, very, very funny guy. The last two questions I want to get into, one of them is a question that you told me when we had lunch last week.
That's
Barbara
right.
Walters' question.
Oh, from Regis.
Regis. Yeah.
Regis brought it up. He said that this was one of the greatest questions.
He brought it up on Larry King Live?
Letterman.
Mm-hmm. Where he was an L. And he comes up and he says, let me see if I get this right.
Yeah.
Given your level of talent,
sure.
Do you feel that you deserve the success you've achieved?
This is an important question.
Okay. That's the question,
that is
right?
The question. Okay, I think everybody should ask themselves that more later in the career. I mean, I've only really been in show business for 7 or 8 years, sure. so I hope the road isn't over yet.
Yeah.
But so far, of course not. I definitely don't think that I deserve everything that I've received. Uh-huh. I've been very, very lucky. I've performed a lot of places. I've seen cities that stayed on Wall Street or in the business.
Is that what you did before this?
I was on Wall Street for a while, and then I worked in news media for a while as well. And had I not branched out into this game.
And you performed in a number of cities. I mean, not just your talk show in the Middle East, but you've performed in many continents.
A couple of continents, mm-hmm.
I've been around.
I've been around. Still itching.
Absolutely.
Poughkeepsie
in 84.
We've been there.
That's where
me and Raj first met.
Little Rock in 92, I tell you, that when Clinton was just getting started.
My shoulder still hurts.
Yeah.
No, I mean, I've been very, very lucky, and I'm very grateful, and, I do recognize that I do not deserve the things that I have, and I hope that I keep going on this streak,
that's amazing.
Life's graciousness with me.
No, but I think you're right to point out that it's a question that's usually asked later in someone's career, because I think right now we all kind of feel like, well, no, we deserve more. Like, we want more. We're aspirational.
We're aspiring.
Which is there. And the second question, and the last thing we'll cover, I believe, is...
Sure.
Going back to the advice that the older man gave you.
Yes.
And if you want to you want to pass it down through him or your own, the only kind of traditional question I ask in these interviews is, what advice do you have for the kids out there? What do you wish you would have known and for anyone that's trying to get into entertainment or show business or comedy or life or anything, I guess we're all in life, right? But anyone who's doing that, what are some pieces of advice that this man may have given you that you want to share with the world that you're just like, the world being my parents who listen to this, by the way.
Right, exactly. Mr. and Mrs. Satyal, great pleasure.
Absolutely. heard a lot about you.
Big fan of your sons.
Yeah.
Really, again, I'm also really, really young to be giving advice. I mean, I really don't know much about life.
Sure.
The only thing that I've picked up for sure along the way, is that try and have a good time.
Yeah. That's the theme with you.
Have a good time. Mm-hmm. Worrying about a problem doesn't eliminate it.
Right.
So you might as well wait for the guillotine to come down.
Yeah.
I really do believe that. Mm-hmm. Like, and usually... I'm saying high 90 percentile. The more you surrender to it, it's usually not as bad as you think.
So kind of go with the flow.
Go with the flow and, be like water, like Bruce Lee says, path of least resistance, all that.
Yeah.
And, just try and have a good time. Everybody struggles.
Right, right, right.
One of the problems in this business especially is that when you're in it, you feel like you're alone and that you're the only one that's constantly being rejected. You're the only one that can't get the spot that you want. You're the only one. Yeah.
Right.
And that's not the case.
Right.
Everybody's struggling, even the people that are all the way on top.
Uh-huh.
And if you don't believe that, look at the people that are on top.
Yeah.
People like, Britney Spears.
Lindsay Lohan.
Dave Chappelle, who had to, here's a guy. He's a brilliant mind, a modern philosopher, a genius comedian, a spokesperson for his people.
Absolutely.
And he had to run to Africa to get centered. You know?
They say there's a fine line between genius and madness.
That's right. And you know, don't let yourself get to madness. Mm-hmm. Just kind of have a good time, you know, have a drink every now and then. Not too much.
No.
Have a smoke every now and
then. A little bit of heroin.
Not too much. And just on your bagel. And,
Not too much. He's in the pizza thing that he's making with Kramer. Not too much. You can't put a cucumber on the pizza.
Yeah. Poppy.
Poppy.
Just try and have a good time. I think those are the people that enjoy the road the most.
Yeah.
You know.
Well, they say happiness is not a destination, it's a journey.
And that's what I found.
But I agree that is true.
Always an adventure.
Cliched for a reason.
Always an adventure.
Speaking of sign-offs, yes. That is my email sign-off, always an adventure.
Right. My good
friend.
Which
is a great segue into a sign-off for this program, because this is the end, part two of two. We have been very very fortunate to have Meena Dimian on the show.
Thank you very much.
Our first non-South Asian on the show.
I'm
but that's
representing
not...
for all Middle Easterners who are trying to break into this forum. And
The forum being the podcast.
That's right here, Rajiv Satyal, funny Indian show.
Of course, absolutely.
Thanks for having me.
But it was a pleasure to have you on. People can look you up at the Gray Wall. Should they Google the Gray Wall? Or should they look
you can
YouTube
the Gray Wall. You can go to funnyourdie.com/Meena, or you can go to... MeenaComedy.com.
Meena Comedy. Yeah. MeenaComedy.
Comedy.com.
Great.
Or Facebook.
Are you / Meena Comedy on there?
No, I'm / Meena Dimian.
Okay.
And I'm also friends with
Rajiv, as it were. So you can go to Facebook.com/ Meena Dimian, which is MeenaDimian. Is that right? And you can always email me, Rajiv@funnyindian.com. Thank you very much for joining us for the Funny Indian Show. I've been your host, Rajiv, and I still am.